Somebody came up on the stage and got a hold of the mic and said, I want to invite everyone here to give their life to Jesus Christ. And I thought, wait a minute, those two things didn't quite go together. And so my wife and I hurried around to the front of the stage to see who it was, and it was Joe Gibbs. Joe Gibbs has a racing team. My wife and I have three nephews that works for him. And before they go to work every morning, they start their work, they kneel down and pray and have Bible study. Kind of interesting. And so here he was praying, inviting people to give their life to Jesus Christ. And so shortly after that, I was walking up to Joe Gibbs at the racetrack. I wanted his autograph. Just as I was getting ready to ask him for his autograph, he says, wait a minute before you ask me anything. He pulls out of his pocket a little religious tract, and he says, I want to give this to you. And I really respected that some people, you know, racing and all other kind of sports, people that love the Lord Jesus Christ. And so tonight as we get started, I want to begin by having an added word of prayer and just ask for the presence of the Holy Spirit to be here with us. Heavenly Father, we give you praise, give you glory. We thank you, Lord, that you're a God who loves us and cares for us, and you want to bring us closer to you. And Lord, I pray tonight that the Holy Spirit that led the men of old to write the scriptures will lead us to understand. Bless us, Father, and we thank you, we praise you. In Jesus' name, amen. I want a foundation that I want to share with you tonight. The foundation is this. I believe this book is the Word of God. I believe that this book, from the book of Genesis all the way through the book of Revelation, will change lives. I believe that it has an answer to every problem and every situation in life. And I believe that this next 10 days, I'm going to share those principles with you of how to be physically, mentally, and spiritually whole in Christ Jesus. Because, you know, it's interesting, just about all religions, if you've been to different churches and different religions, they all teach something spiritual, right? But, you know, there's more to it. I believe that God wants me to be physically whole. Amen? I believe that he wants to take care of my mind and mold and make that. I believe that that's one of the things we'll take to heaven with us, is the character that God has molded and made. These old bodies, I'm going to tell you what, these old bodies, they're going back to the dust of the ground. But the mind, the character, that's what we want to work on. And praise the Lord, that's what the Bible does for us. So yes, I believe it is the Word of God. I believe that two books, the book of Daniel, the book of Revelation, if we study those two books together, along with other parts of the Bible, I believe that we'll have a reformation, a revival. I believe something will happen in our lives and change us. And friends, you know, look at the world today. I was amazed that this little brochure, if you didn't get one of these in the mail, I have a few on the table here. It's kind of interesting. Just listen to this. Extreme weather. You know what the temperature's been this past week in the mountains? In the 60s. And I'm sure it's down here, probably in the 70s, probably. Raging fires. Have you been seeing things on the news about Australia? Boy, it's crazy. Broken homes. Crime. Cancer and cruelty out of control. Every form of cancer today, there's something's going on. Something's happening in this world. And then, this one here, as you open it up, showdown in the Middle East. Does that sound like the news just recently? Wow. And, you know, it's amazing that these things, you say, well, how did you know all those things, that those things were going to be happening when you started this seminar? Well, I know it's going to happen because it's in this book. I mean, if you want to read a chapter, one chapter that'll change your life, it's Matthew chapter 24. It's all about the signs and the prophecies. But also is Revelation. So tonight, turn in your Bibles. If you brought your Bible with you, great. If you didn't, there's one in the pews there in front of you. You can use that. And if But I would like for you to bring your Bible, so that way you feel more comfortable with it as you open it. And let me tell you a little bit about myself. I became a Christian 49 years ago, and I've been a Christian ever since. And I've been sharing these things from Daniel and Revelation for 49, almost 50 years now. And the more I share, the more I see, hey, Jesus, here's the gospel. Listen to this. This is the gospel from Genesis all the way through Revelation. Get ready for this. Jesus loves me. This I know, for the Bible tells me so. That's it. Isn't that wonderful? Because that's everything. Jesus loves me, this I know. You know how I learned that song? As I mentioned, my parents were bootleggers, and that's how racing and all came about, was through bootleggers. And we owned a beer joint, and so my mother and dad, they weren't church-going people. But my mother is a gambler. Boy, she could gamble. She could play bingo. She spent 1 year $24,000 just on bingo. But she won almost $19,000, so she felt like she did pretty good. So my mother was a gambler, and so my mom, she heard that the little Methodist church in our hometown, just down the road from our beer joint, my mother heard that if you would send your children to Sunday school for a full year and not miss a Sunday, that you could win a little pin to put on your shirt. So Mom took me, not my brothers and sisters, but took me every Sunday morning, dropped me off, went back home, and after Sunday school came back and picked me up. And I did that for a whole year. And I never got to wear that pin. She wore it. That's a real gambler, right? But the one thing I learned during those 12 months of going to church every Sunday, as that little Sunday school teacher would walk me out to the car so I wouldn't get lost between Sunday school and where my mother was parked to pick me up, she'd put her arm around me, and this is what she'd say. She'd say, "Johnny, never forget, Jesus loves you." And I want to tell you, those words have helped me through a lot of difficult times. You see, my sister and I were decoys for my bootlegging parents. And what they would do is, we had an old station wagon, and my dad would place those seats down, and he would put on top of those seats, as they were laying there in the back of that station wagon, beer, moonshine, liquor, cover them in with blankets, and my sister and I would lie on top of that. And when the police would stop my parents as they were carrying it to dry counties, and they would pull my parents over, and this happened several times, and they'd shine their light back there on us kids. My mother would say, "Now don't wake up the children, they're back there sleeping." And we were on top of that stuff. And so I know what that kind of lifestyle is all about. And even during the times as I was growing up, and I watched and listened to my mom and dad when they'd start drinking, listen to them fight verbally, physically. There's a lot of bloodshed. And I'd cry in my bedroom because I could hear them through the walls. And I could remember what that little Sunday school teacher would say, "Johnny, never forget, Jesus loves you." And I called upon him many, many times. And years later, by the way, how many of you remember the day when the Gideons would come around to the public schools and give out the little New Testament Bibles? Mm-hmm. Anybody? Y'all not old enough.
I still have one.
Yeah, you're not old enough. You got to go back. Yeah, you remember. Got to be old like me. And I was in the fourth grade. And And the Gideons came around and gave us a Bible. And I kept that Bible beside my bed. And I wrote all in that Bible. When I'd hear my parents screaming at each other and fighting, I'd open that thing and I'd write, "Dear Lord, make them stop." You know? And you know, I never heard from my mother nor my dad the words, "I love you." So I didn't know what love was all about, you know? Didn't understand it. But now they loved us because they fed us. They gave us our beer and our baby bottles and stuff. I mean, we had everything we needed. And we had all that stuff. And we'd take clothing. They took care of us. Good Christmases. Bootleggers made good money. And so we didn't have to worry about those kind of things that a lot of people do worry about. But boy, the love wasn't there. And so when I got married, you know, I didn't understand love because I watched my mom run around on my dad, and I watched my dad run around on my mom. So it wasn't there. The love, didn't understand it until the night I gave my life to Jesus Christ.
Amen.
You see, I used to say, whenever I get married, I'll never treat my wife the way my mom and dad treated each other. But you know what? Isn't it amazing how the family tree seems to do the same thing? And so here I was, becoming an alcoholic, doing the same thing, my wife and I fighting. Our home, we were on the verge of divorce after the birth of our first child. It was about to end because of my drinking, the drugs. My wife had had enough. And the night she read a Bible text to me, and it caused me to give my life to Jesus Christ. I'm going to share that verse with you later on in our seminar, because there's power in Bible text. Did you know that? There's something about my word will not come back void. There's something about the word, and it changed my life, and it changed our home. And we were able to bring our three beautiful daughters up in a Christian home. And there's a lot of stories to that also. By the way, I've got three daughters, 5 grandkids, 3 daughters. There's 25 years between our middle daughter and our youngest daughter. Same daddy, mama. 25 years. And my oldest daughter helped in the delivery of her sister. Gave her first bath, first shots. And my middle daughter and my wife were pregnant at the same time. This really gets complicated. So, my daughter was an aunt before she was born. Got a grandson 2 years older than she is. And so they don't call her Aunt Carrie. You know, they don't do that because she's the same age as most of the grandkids. And anyway, it's been fun. You know, they told us, they said, you know what? If you have children in your old age, it'll keep you young. And that is a lie. It's no truth to that whatsoever. This kid has given me more gray hairs than the other two put together. But hey, I love them. Love our children. Revelation, if you've got the Bible right there, look at it. Revelation chapter 1, verse 1. Now, you're probably thinking, with me telling all these stories, it's going to be hard to get through Revelation. But I'm not going to keep you late each night. We're going to go morning meeting, and the evening meeting is 1 hour, right at 1 hour long. And that's it, the total time, 7 to 8. So don't worry about that. It's not going to be late. I'm not a long-winded preacher. But here it is, Revelation 1 gives us our setting. Revelation 1, verse 1. The revelation of John the Divine. Is that what it says? The revelation of Peter. What does it say? Oh. That's the title of the message. The revelation of who? The Bible tells us who it's the revelation of. Amen. It's the revelation of Jesus Christ. Now, here's what I want us to find in Revelation. Now, we will go to other books of the Bible. Every so often we'll turn to something else in comparing text. And And so, because the Bible says when you study God's Word, it says study a little here, a little there, line upon line, precept upon precept. What that means is the whole Bible is inspired, amen? From Genesis all the way through Revelation. So when you read something in Revelation, you don't understand what it means, it will be explained someplace in the Word of God. Now here's the big problem with religion. Is that people take religion and they'll take the Bible and they try to go outside of the Bible to explain the Bible, and that is wrong. You don't explain the Word outside of the Word. If you can't find an explanation for something in the Bible, then silence is golden. Okay? But in just about 99% of the time, you will find the answer to a question in this book. So Revelation is the revelation of Jesus Christ. So what that means is, all of Revelation is about Jesus. Now somebody says, but wait a minute. Revelation 13 talks about a man with a number 666. The Antichrist. Yeah, it does. But it's amazing in Revelation 13, it's all about the Lamb. Even though it's about the Antichrist. So the reason we have in the Bible, God wants us to know who the Antichrist is. And I'm going to tell you something. In the 10 nights, you're going to know who he is. Because the Bible tells us. Even got a little booklet. I'll give you a copy of this when we get down the night of the Antichrist revealed. Called Antichrist Revealed, Mr. 666. Goes into detail, explaining all from the Bible who the man is with the number. I'll give you a copy of that when we get to that. But I don't want us to miss what it's talking about. So here's what I did. It says it's the revelation of Jesus Christ. So I decided if the Bible, if Revelation is the revelation of Jesus Christ, maybe the whole book is the revelation of Jesus Christ. So I went and studied the book of Genesis, very first book of the Bible, and I spent several years just on Genesis. Because here's what I wanted to do. I wanted to find every truth that's found in this book, in the first book of the Bible, Genesis, and I found it. Every doctrine, every truth that God wants us to know about in the book of Genesis. So then I thought, wow, if I can find all these truths in Genesis, maybe I can do the same thing in Revelation. And that's what happened. I found every Bible doctrine and truth that God wants me and you to know in the book of Revelation. So then I thought, wow, this is incredible. If everything is truth in Genesis and everything is truth, all the truths are in Revelation, then what about all those books in between? And it's all about Jesus. If you leave the Lamb, Jesus Christ, out of any Bible subject or doctrine, that is blasphemy. Are you with me? It's all about Jesus. Oh, I love it. So what do you find in Revelation chapter 1? Well, in verse 1 there, it's the revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave unto him to show unto his servants things which must shortly come to pass. He sent and signified it by his angel unto his servant John. Now don't miss this. Here in this very first verse is the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. You say, well, wait a minute, where's the Holy Ghost? Well, that's the power of the Holy Ghost is what spoke to the angel and to the servant John. You see, and we'll see that here in just a few minutes. Who bear record of the Word of God and of the testimony of Jesus Christ of all things that he saw. Now, friends, don't miss the next verse. To me, this is very powerful here in the heart of, or in this first chapter. Blessed. Now the word blessed means happy. peace, joy, all those things, you know, it's found in the New Testament about really being happy and peaceful and all those great things that God lists. He says, blessed is he that what?
Read.
All right, stop right here. Do you know there are religions that teach that the book of Revelation is not for the Christian? That's right. I'm not going to start naming churches and religions because, but there are. There are some that teach that the first three chapters can be used by the Christians, but after that it doesn't even apply to the Christian. Friends, I believe that every chapter, every verse, everything is to every man and woman. Amen? And child. So what happens is somebody comes along and says, hey, this is not for the Christian. So what happens? Christians don't read it. When you got a pastor standing up and saying, hey, it's not for the church, it's not for the Christians, we won't be here, we'll be gone when all this happens. So people don't study. People say it's a confused book and a closed book. But do you know what? When a person says it's a closed book and we can't understand it and we shouldn't study it, you know what they're trying to do to me? They're trying to take away from me a blessing. Because it says right here, blessed is he that reads. That's pretty powerful, amen? Amen. Blessed is he that readeth. Now we got to make something clear here. Some of us are not readers. I'm one of them. I don't like to read. In school, see, I only made it 10th grade. Dale was in the 9th. I was 1 year older than Dale, and so he got kicked out in the 9th. I got kicked out the 10th. Told not to ever come back to school again. So we got into cars and stuff. But I didn't like to read. Man, book reports. I'd read the first page and the last page, and I'd make my report. And so many times the teacher would say, now, Johnny, that's not what the book was about. I said, yeah, I read the, you know. Now, my wife's a reader. Oh, she reads all. We get in the car, she starts reading. And she said, I'm going to read you since you don't like to read. But now, I learned, people are different. You know, I'm auditory. That means I learn from hearing. I've got Bible on cassette, you know, that's gone, isn't it? I got it on CD. Now you can get it on a little thing you stick in your ear. I don't know. They got all kind of crazy stuff out there. But look, let's read the rest of the verse. Here it is, verse 3. Blessed is he that readeth, and they that hear the words of this prophecy, and keep those things which are written therein, for the time is at hand. God says, I'm going to bless you abundantly if you will read, if you will hear, and if you'll follow the things of Revelation. Right. So I listen to it. So I'm still learning. You don't like to read? Listen to it. How many remember cassette? Some of you young people don't know what a cassette is. I mean, this world is going by so fast. You know, it's crazy, isn't it? Let me show you something. You got to see this. Let me show you. I think it's still in my jacket. I didn't lose it. I mean, it's going by so fast. What do I do with it? Oh, here it is. This is where I am. You young people don't know what this is. This is a telephone. My kids, my grandkids, they fuss at me all the time. You need to upgrade. They call me Peepaw, my grandkids do. You need to upgrade. Hey, listen. I've upgraded. this is it. This is everything. And I believe everything in it. It's the Word of God. Blessed is he that readeth, that keep those things, those that hear. Let's go on, boy. There's some powerful verses here. Verse 5. We'll come back to some of the verses as we move along this week. Verse 5 says, and from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness, the first begotten of the dead, and the prince of the kings of the earth. And here's the part, don't miss this. Unto him, Jesus Christ, that loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood. That's what it's all about. There's power in the blood of Jesus Christ. Do you know there's a real problem in our world today? NASCAR asked me, what can you do to get people coming back to NASCAR? They're losing fans. But it's not just NASCAR. Football, baseball. That age of about 16 to about 45, that age group is into those phones and movies and everything else that's out there just beaming down. And it's not only sports, but I'm going to tell you something. There's a problem in the churches today.
Amen.
Young people have saw enough hypocrites. You know? And that's sad. You know, kids look and they're smart today. I mean, look, their minds are so smart and they're looking at things and people and boy. My youngest daughter just got married. She's in that age group. Soon to be 25. Just got married back, when was it, November? She eloped. But I was invited. They got married up on a mountainside in the mountain. Beautiful. You could see for miles and miles around. She only invited about 8-9 people. It was kind of an elopement. Next day we had the party. She married a redneck.
Yeah.
Like me.
Yeah.
That ain't good. Good old boy. Living in my basement. I thought when you got married you had to leave, especially if you eloped. But it's all right. It's all right. This is our last young lady. The other two daughters are off, got their families. Now our daughter, our youngest daughter. I'm talking to her husband about Jesus. When we study the Bible together, he gets his Bible and he comes up and he studies with us. He's open. I believe that most young men and women are open and just waiting for somebody to show them a better way. Amen. And the better way is walking in the book of Revelation, walking with Jesus Christ. Amen?
Amen.
Here back a few months ago, one of my granddaughters, my youngest is 14. No, she'll soon be 16. 15, soon be 16. My wife and I, a year and a half, 2 years ago, celebrated our big 50. So the daughters and grandkids got a cabin up in the mountains of near Boone, North Carolina. We all got together that weekend and we took a hike on Saturday afternoon and boy, anybody ever been to Boone? Oh, it's beautiful up there, those waterfalls. So we're out there walking, the whole family, 5 grandkids, and my 3 daughters, and husbands, and friends, and we're taking a hike and walking up beside a waterfall, and people jumping in the water there and swimming and all, and we've taken a good long hike, and we're coming back down by the waterfall, and my granddaughter kind of veers off the path and is walking into the water in her clothes. And I said, "Sweetheart, what you doing?" And she said, "Peepaw, come on. I want you to baptize me." Nobody told me about it. I didn't know this was going to happen. And I baptized my granddaughter. Wow. It's powerful. You know that? Giving her life to Jesus Christ. What makes me want to cry. Good tears, though. Joy. Because it says here in Revelation, this verse 5, He's done something for us. He loved us. He washed us from our sins by His blood. Anybody ever heard that song? Power in the Blood. Oh, wow. And I believe that. I believe with all my heart that there is power in the blood. Let me share something with you. I took some notes here on something I heard a few years ago, but I want to share this with you because this is what's going to come out of these 10 days, all right? 10 days, 10 nights, whichever. Or come to both. You know, I've got people that will come in the mornings and they'll come at night too. And same people. So they've heard it in the morning and they come here at night. And I ask them, I said, "Well, didn't you get it this morning?" I said, "No, I like to come at night and see if you change your stories." That's possible. You might hear different ones because I don't use a lot of notes. So, but here's what I found about what this will do for us during these 10 days, 10 nights. Positive mind attracts positive events. Some of these you got to really think about. If you make a positive thinking your priority, you will always make a great first impression. Positive thinking is very beneficial for your health. Physical. To be positive. Did you know that the main cause of stress is worry and negative thoughts? Do you know why people can't sleep at night? They're lying there in the bed thinking about all these crazy things. My wife has a little back problem. Sometimes she has trouble sleeping. So she keeps me up. Now, last night, she couldn't sleep. "Oh, my back's bothering me." So I get up. My wife uses, anybody ever use those things they call essential oils? You know what I'm talking about? Frankincense, greenbrier. I don't think that's one. They're all kind of oils. So she tells me, she says, "All right, I want you to just put all this stuff on my back." So I had her covered. Hands just sliding all over the place. I thought her mom could still smell it. You know, after a shower and everything else. But anyway, she went right to sleep. Just like a baby. But my wife is the most positive person. Listen to this one. Positive thinking and optimistic attitude will turn all your problems into opportunities.
Amen.
Whoa! Come on now. Positive attitude will boost your motivation and you will start to achieve your goals quicker and easier. Positive thinking will make you look more beautiful. Come on, ladies. Us men need that too. It happens naturally. Smiling, friendly, and happy people are extremely attractive. Wow. I've got some more. I'll share some more later. I like that stuff. The revelation. All right. I I got another story I got to tell you. Go back to verse 3. Blessed is he that reads and hears. Oh, man. How many of you have ever gone to the DMV and enjoyed it? Listen, I don't know about your DMV here, but our DMV up there near Asheville, no matter what day of the week you go, there's going to be a long line. So I recommend the people, if the place opens at 8 in the morning, you be there at 6. In line, at the door. I've actually done that before, because it gets so crowded. Well, we had been living in South Carolina for a good while. I was born and raised in North Carolina, up near Charlotte, Kannapolis, Salisbury area. And so North Carolina, born and raised here. My wife was also. So when we got to the age, you know, we've always had a North Carolina license while we lived in North Carolina, driver's license. But we had moved out. We had lived in South Carolina for some years. And so anyway, when we moved back to North Carolina, we're living now, like I mentioned, up close to Asheville. When we moved back to North Carolina, we had to go and transfer our driver's license from South Carolina to North Carolina. You know how you do that. So we go to the DMV. I thought it would be a simple thing of just taking my driver's license, placing it on the counter there, the lady taking it, transferring it over, and give me a North Carolina license. But whether you know this or not, you're about to learn something about the DMV and North Carolina. If you've been out of the state of North Carolina over 5 years, you have to take the test over again. So I didn't know that. We'd been out of state for about 8-9 years. So I walk up to the counter and I said, ma'am, my wife and I are here. We just moved back to North Carolina. Here's my South Carolina driver's license. We'd like to transfer it over to North Carolina. She says to me, well, you got to take the test. I thought she was teasing. Those DMV people don't tease. And they don't smile. You know, I mean, they can look. Anybody here work for the DMV? Anyway, this lady's not smiling. And I thought she was trying to crack a joke saying I'd have to take these tests. But she was serious. She said, I notice on your South Carolina driver's license that you drive a motorcycle. I said, yes, ma'am. I've been driving ever since I was 14. I got my license when I was 14. I was living in Florida at the time. My dad packed up the whole family and moved us out of North Carolina to Florida because the law was looking for all the bootleggers, and he just packed us all up and got us out of there. And so at the age of 14, I was able to go and get my driver's license, so I had a motorcycle. At the age of 14, driving that thing all over the place. This lady says, I see you got a motorcycle license on your regular license. She says, you're also going to have to take the test over for the motorcycle. I said, you know, kind of pushing my chest out. Well, that's all right. I've been driving motorcycles ever since I was 14. I know how to drive a motorcycle. I passed that test. She said, you think so? How many have gone to get license renewed or either got a driver's license recently? It's all computer. Remember what kind of phone I've got? I mean, my wife goes and sits down there at the computer, lights all over the place. There's at least 100 people waiting to be served. But it was our turn. So my wife sits down there at the computer. You can't miss over 3. Or 4, and then you fail the test. But anyway, my wife sits down there. Man, she got every question right. She got up. You know when somebody's proud how they walk? She got her driver's license. My turn. I go sit down at the computer. I passed the drive. I missed one or maybe two of the driving part, but I was happy about passing that. And then the lady said, now you got to take the motorcycle test. So I sat down there. Questions like this. If you're on a motorcycle and you're going down the road and you veer off the road or you run off the road and you don't have a helmet on, how long is it going to take you to die? Well, I don't know. So I missed that one. And I missed the second. And I missed the third one. And when I went to do the fourth one and I missed it, lights went off all over the place. Blinking. And the lady that wouldn't smile, who said I had to take the two tests, she shouted out in the midst of all those 100 people, you failed the test, didn't you? Everybody's looking at me. After I missed the first one, I'm starting to sweat. When I missed the second one, the sweat went from my head to my chest. When I missed the third one, it moved down on my thigh. And when I missed and the lights went all off, I was sweating from the top of my head to the bottom of my feet. I'd never sweated like that before. Those were the brightest lights I've ever seen. And my wife, standing over there smiling and laughing. So I get up from the table, and I can see people looking at me. And my wife, she's got her license. She's walking out. It's time to go. So I'm following behind her. She's walking like this, and she's just so proud. And I got my head down. And when I get right there where that lady was that shouted out that I failed the test, all of a sudden, she shouts out so that everybody would hear her. She says, here, read the book. And it was a motorcycle book to take the test. I've never read a book about how to drive a motorcycle. So I took the book, walked out the door. My wife was going over to the passenger side. I said, no, you're going to have to drive. I failed. I can't drive. I don't know how to drive anymore. You know, I can't pass no test. So she drove me home. I've never been so depressed and down because I thought, hey, I've been driving a motorcycle for 50-some years. This was crazy. Do you know what I did that weekend? I read that book from cover to cover, over and over again. When my grandkids came over that weekend, I gave them the book. I said, ask me a question. And they quizzed me and quizzed me. And that next week, I went back in. And that little lady, I don't know how she remembered me because so many people go in and out of that place. And she said, oh, you're back again, huh? Like she was going to really get me. I said, go over to the computer. Went over and I sat down. I missed the first one. Again, I started to sweat. I'm thinking, I know, I read the book. And then after that, though, I got every one of them right. And I got my motorcycle license, my driver's license, all in one thing. I learned a lesson from that. I want to close with this. We might think we have all the answers. Are you with me? We might think just because we've been taught a certain way that we've got it all down right. But I want to tell you something. If we don't read the book, we're going to fail the test. Because the book is clear. It's the revelation Jesus Christ. So we're going to be studying, starting tomorrow morning, right on through 10 days. We're going to be looking at Revelation and just what you found tonight. There's a blessing. We've been washed by the blood. The Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit wants to take full control of my life and your life. Will we let Him do it? Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we want to praise You tonight for Your Word. We want to praise You for the book. We've learned tonight, Lord, we need to read the book. Are we going to pass the test or not? Well, salvation is not by what we do, it's by what He did. But Lord, we got to know how to give our lives to You. We got to know how to allow You to take us through these troublesome times. We got to realize that You are the answer. We got to realize that we need to cast all our cares upon You, for You care for us. Lord, save us, not in our sins, but from our sins. And Lord, these next 9 and 10 days,